elucidating the process of DNA replication, RNA transcription, and protein translation revolutionized biology forever. Molecular genetics now is at the forefront of the field, and this is the result of an extraordinary amount of work. And we don't really have time to go over the whole history of this, but I just want to make a few points. It was known for some time, about the middle of the 20th century, that our cells contained chromosomes, and it seemed pretty likely that the chromosomes were the material of inheritance. But if you recall, the way the DNA molecule is all wound up, it wraps itself around these little bits of protein called histones, and there are other protein structures involved to give you this familiar shape of a replicated chromosome that looks like an X. Well, so what was the actual bit that was passed on from one generation to the other? What was the actual material of inheritance? It wasn't until 1951 that people were able, with the tools available to them in those days, to actually look carefully at what the DNA molecule actually was, how it was actually shaped. And so this was first done by a British scientist named Maurice Wilkins in 1951 using X-ray crystallography. There's a vague sense that there's something complicated going on with this molecule. It wasn't until 1953 when another British biologist named Rosalind Franklin was able to do a much higher resolution X-ray crystallography. And believe it or not, for people who do this sort of thing, she was able to deduce from the structure that she could see with her tools that the DNA was probably a helical molecule. And if it's helical, then there was all kinds of scope for a lot of information being encoded over long stretches of this molecule. And so it was famously Watson and Crick, James Watson and Francis Crick, who in one of the most famous scientific papers ever written in 1953 had the schematic view of what the DNA double helix actually looked like and how you'd have these complementary nitrogenous bases on either side, saying, "It has not escaped our notice that the specific pairing we have postulated immediately suggests a possible copying mechanism for the genetic material. So if this strand is all going to be Gattaca, and only G with C and A with T, then its complementary strand would likewise be constrained, and if they were separated temporarily, each used as a template to reconstruct a double molecule again, they'd be identical." That was the key insight that led to people realizing this is the stuff of inheritance. This is the repository of information that can be transferred from one generation to the next. And so from that, we then got the central dogma in molecular biology that the ultimate repository of all information of our bodily structures is encoded in the DNA, in that deoxyribonucleic acid, that it's transcribed into messenger RNA, a form of ribonucleic acid, and this then is translated into protein. For these insights, Watson and Crick and Wilkins won the Nobel Prize in 1962. Rosalind Franklin's work was also considered worthy of a Nobel, but she unfortunately died in 1958. This led to an extraordinary number of Nobel Prizes, and again, as I've said, a revolution in biology. The preeminence now of molecular biology in almost every aspect of biology is truly astonishing, given that this was only discovered a few decades ago. So, more recently, what a lot of emphasis has been focused on has been what's called genomics. And this is actually going through and getting that long sequence of Gattaca, 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 Gattaca of the entire DNA of an individual organism. So we sequence the entire region of DNA, all the chromosomes, GACTA, over and over and over again to see how the organism is actually coded, I mean, what its instructions are for building all of its proteins. And so the first genome was decoded of a virus in 1976. Following that, the first bacterial genome was decoded in 1997. And then in 2006 was the first draft of the human genome, an extraordinary accomplishment that will no doubt revolutionize our understanding of physical illnesses, inherited diseases for generations to come. The genomics has now been done in a lot of different species, and what we will concentrate on are the number of base pairs. So a chicken has 2.2 billion base pairs. A honeybee has 3.6 billion base pairs. So this is Gattaca, 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 3.6 billion times long. A horse is 4.2 billion. Dog, 4.8. Rats, 5.5. Corn, 5.6. Cats, cows, elephants, 6 billion. And chimps and humans, over 6 billion. Large amount of information, huge amount of work that's gone into getting that precise sequence of Gattaca all the way along in all of our genes. Associated with this now is, well, okay, that's a lot of Gattaca, but then as we've seen with the exons and the introns, not everything gets translated into proteins. And so now, one of the exciting fields in molecular biology is called proteomics. And this is where we're trying to get the sequence of every protein in an individual organism. And just to give you a sense of what these are like, just a few examples. Hemoglobin, which transports oxygen in our blood, is a protein consisting of 574 amino acids. So valine, serine, leucine, all those things going along, 574 of them. When we get a cold, our immune system produces antibodies, and antibody to the common cold is about 700 amino acids long. Muscle tissue has myosin, which powers the muscle fiber, and this is a much longer protein of about 2,000 amino acids. As we'll see in the coming weeks, molecular genetics is a young and thriving field with enormous implications for understanding evolution, health, and well-being in all living things.